Well, it's good to be back with you after a couple of weeks off, and I hope that you enjoyed hearing from Larry Osborne. He's one of my mentors. He is an incredible leader and gave a couple of great messages for us here at South Bay, and so I was very blessed by that. Hope you were as well. And today we are continuing our Spirituality for the Rest of Us message series, and I have a little bit of a confession to make today on the front end of my message. Every once in a while, I'll go through all of my preparation, and my personality, just so you know, I like to nail it down, I like to be organized, I don't like to change things last minute. And when I woke up today and I'm starting to pray through and put the final touches on today's message, I just felt like God was saying, I want you to change about 50% of what you were going to say. So if it's really bad, that's why, okay? You can blame God if it's bad. So today what I want to do, though, is I want to talk to you about how do you walk through difficulty? How do you walk through trial? How do you walk through struggles in your life? And how is it that God uses struggle, tragedy, difficulty in our lives to form us and shape us? Because this entire series really is about God forming us and making us into the person that He has created us to be. Now, to get us started today, here's what I'd like to do. I want you to think of a time in the past in your life where there was something you wanted and you didn't get it. There was something that you had longed for, that you hoped for. For me, it was a girlfriend a couple of times, and it never worked out. What was that thing that you hoped would happen? Maybe something you gave energy to, passion to, long hours to, and it didn't come out the way that you had hoped it to. Or maybe another way to think of it is like this. Something you attempted, and when you attempted that thing, you failed. Okay, so get that in your mind. Write it down on your notes. Put it in a bucket somewhere so that you know. Put it on your hand. That area of life where there was struggle, where there was tragedy, where there was difficulty in your life. So get it into categories. Think about it right there. Pause it for a second. Now we're going to flip it. And I want you to think on the other side of the coin about a time where everything worked exactly the way you wanted it to. Maybe there's very few days like that in our lives, but every once in a while we have those days. Or maybe a season of life. It was something you tried, you gave your best energy to, your prayer to, your passion to, and it went almost exactly as you thought it would go. It was an easy moment for you. For lack of better words, it's the, like, hanging out on the beach with the Mai Tai or a Corona or, you know, not that, you know, everybody has to drink, but, you know, it's just like those moments in life where it just goes exactly the way you wanted it to go. Now, here's the question. When you look back over the course of your life, which of those two? The easy moments in life or the difficult moments of life? The seeming great successes of your life or the struggle of your life? Which of those two categories have been most defining in the person that you've become today? Now, if you're anything like me and you're anything like most of the rest of us, the answer is it's difficulty. It's trial. It's struggle. It's walking through moments of life where it doesn't turn out the way that we hoped it would. That is God's greatest tool in our lives to form us and shape us into the person that He's created us to be. And if you're taking notes, here's what I want to talk to you about today. Life's greatest struggles, right within the middle of them, contain life's greatest opportunities for your character to be shaped. Right in the middle of your greatest difficulty, that situation, that circumstance that came to your mind when I said it, right tucked within that struggle is the greatest opportunity for God to form and to shape you and I to become the person that He has created us to be. And here's what concerns me for my life and for my generation, for all of us, especially as we have this new social media age. Here's what has happened with us in social media. See, everybody puts out on social media the best food that they ate. Nobody puts out their ramen or, you know, the fifth night of leftovers that they had on Instagram. It's always the best that we throw out. And here's what we think. We look at everybody else's life. We look at their successes. We look at their pictures. We look at their posts. And we think, I'm the only one who struggles. I'm the only one who walks through difficulty. Anybody else ever feel like that? Like everybody else has got it all together, and I'm the lone person on planet Earth who's depressed, who's struggling, who's frustrated, who's discouraged. And that mentality for us oftentimes can lead us down a path of discouragement and ultimately destruction. And for you and I, when it comes to that struggle that came to our minds when we threw it out there, that struggle, the way that you and I respond to it makes all the difference. And there are some people who walk through difficulty. There are some people who walk through trial and tragedy, and their life gets worse. And there are some people who walk through it, and through the power and the strength and the compassion, the help of God, they are formed and shaped into the person that God has created them to be. And the perspective that you and I have, the way we receive it, the way we perceive it, makes all the difference. And today, for a few moments that we have together, I want to talk to you about your perception of your struggle. And my hope is that you, through this message, would get this infusion of an encouragement into your heart, that you would have a new sense of hope as you walk out of our time together today. And to help us, we're going to go all the way to the New Testament of John chapter 9. There's a story where Jesus interacts with a guy who's been blind from birth. And you can find that on YouVersion, or you can turn into Bible there. And I want to just share the story with you. There's this guy, and he's sitting down on the side of the road, and Jesus is traveling with his followers. Now, if you can imagine, there were probably several dozen people that are around Jesus, and they walk up, and when they get to this scene, they see a guy who's sitting by the side of the road who's blind. And the scripture teaches us that this guy has been blind from birth, which means that there's never been one day in his entire life that he's been able to capture the beauty of a sunset or a day where he could see the smile in his daughter's face. He has literally been blind from birth. And Jesus walks up with his disciples, and when they get upon the scene, his disciples ask this question. They say this to Jesus: "Why was this man born blind? Was it because of his own sins or his parents' sins?" Now, think about the situation just for a second with me. Here is this guy, and these disciples of Jesus, these followers of Jesus, are literally treating him like a science experiment. Like, I wonder if they're peeking up inside of his eyelids, trying to figure out, they can look into his eyes and see the sin from his past. They're like, "Jesus, what is it that caused this guy to be blind?" Now, kind of the humor, I think, in this passage is that they asked Jesus, was it a sin that he committed that made him blind, but he was blind when he was born? It's just, go figure that one out. And then I wonder what they're expecting Jesus to say. Like, "Yeah, this guy's dad was a Seahawks fan, and that's why he was born blind." Sorry, I know that was a low cut right there. Or this guy right here, his mom, she stayed in the shower for 10 minutes too long when there was a drought, and it was her sin, and this guy's blind. I mean, what were they expecting Jesus to say? And here's what I want us to notice: that the same place that Jesus' disciples go to when there's difficulty, the same place that they go to when there's struggle, is the same place that you and I go to when we walk through difficulty. You go through a miscarriage, you're struggling financially, you lose your job, your marriage is on the rocks, you've been single a little bit longer than you thought you would be, and the same place the disciples go is the same place we go, and it's this question: what sin am I being punished for, God? What was it that I did in my past that is resulting in my current struggle? Have you ever done that before, where you've asked yourself the question, was there something that I did way back when that caused me to get into the situation or the predicament that I'm in right now? And there is a critical assumption that we make with struggle that is so important to identify. It's the lens, it's the cracked lens through which we often look at struggle in our lives. And it's this assumption, this is the first one I want us to write down, is this: that I'm being punished for my past. And here's what happens. We get into trial, we get into struggle, we get into difficulty, and we ask ourselves the wrong questions. And when we ask ourselves the wrong questions, we find ourselves discouraged, deflated, frustrated. We lose hope in God. We lose the ability to persevere. We lose the lesson, the training, the forming, and the shaping that God wants to do in our lives. The question of, am I being punished for something from my past, is the wrong question. In fact, we're going to see Jesus respond to his followers in this passage and rebuke them for their questioning of this man and his parents and whether or not their sin caused the struggle. But here's what I want us to stop and pause for a second, a little caveat. There is a major difference in life between God's discipline and the way we perceive punishment. And punishment and discipline are two entirely different things. I remember one time there was this dad. He was kind of a southern guy, and I was talking to him, and he's talking about his children's behavior. And he made this statement. He said, "You know, I just decided my kids were so bad every day that when they woke up in the morning, I was just going to beat them first thing in the morning. Because I was just going to remind them all the stupid, awful, rotten things they did the day before and remind them they better not do any of that again today." That's punishment, okay? That's like just beating you, the tar out of you, because you did something in your past. Punishment is about our past. That's why we do prison. You know, prison is to punish people for something they've done and to keep them off the streets. And that punishment is not about forming and shaping them for the future. It's a punishment for a previous choice. Yet God does something entirely different. God is not about punishment. God is about discipline. And God's discipline is always about the future. It's always about training, forming, and shaping us for the future person that he is creating us to be. And I want us to look very briefly at a passage of scripture found in Hebrews chapter 11. I'm going to start off in verse number 5, talking about this concept of God's discipline in our lives. Excuse me, verse number 7 says this: endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons. For what son is not disciplined by their father? Now, I've seen a lot of children who are not disciplined by their parents. That's why he goes on to make this statement. If you are not disciplined and everyone undergoes some kind of discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons. That's why if you have a babysitter that comes over your house and they don't like the way your kids are acting and they decide to pull out the spoon and just start beating your kids, they're not coming back over again because they're not your kids. But you might do something not quite as bad, but you would train and discipline your children because they're your kids. So don't go spanking my kids. You might give my kids a timeout, but don't go spanking my kids because they're my kids. There's a different ownership. There's a different buy-in. There's a different heart condition that comes with a parent to their children of training them for who the person that they ultimately will become one day. It says then, moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us for a while and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and live? Our fathers disciplined us for a while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, that we might share in his holiness. See, God takes us through difficulty. God causes us at times to be in over our heads or allows us to struggle because there's something that he wants to form and shape in our character. And oftentimes, I just want it to be easy. My concept of holiness oftentimes is, you know, I want to feel holy. I don't want to be holy. I just want to feel holy. And you know when I feel holy? I feel holy when I'm by myself, when I'm on a beach, I'm chilling, I'm listening to some great music. That's when I feel holy. But Scripture says that's not the kind of holiness that God is forming and shaping in us. That God, the same way a father will work with his child or a mother will train and discipline her children, is the same way that God is forming us out of grace, out of love, out of compassion. And I love this last little verse. It says, no discipline seems pleasant at the time. Captain Obvious, thank you for that one. But painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who've been trained by it. See, so often in life, what I want is I want pleasure on the front end. I want life to be easy right now. But what Scripture teaches us is that when we walk through trial and difficulty, there is pleasure, there is blessing, there is fruitfulness, there is character formation in our lives that comes out of every single one of our struggles that is submitted to the hand, to the grace, and to the love of God. And this question about what sin am I being punished for is one of the most destructive questions that you and I can ask ourselves. Now, let me just stay on my little rant here about this subject, okay? There are several reasons, just from a purely logical standpoint, why this is a problem for us to ask the question, what sin caused me to be in my situation that I am right now? Because, number one, if you're anything like me, you have way too many sins to figure that out. There are way too many moments of my life in my life where I was jealous, where I was selfish, where I was arrogant, and to put the finger on what one sin in the past caused me to be in my predicament right now is just, it's frustrating. It puts you into this circular line of thought that you can never figure out what is that exact one sin that caused me to be in the situation I'm in. The second reason that it's a problem for us is that every situation in life that you and I can endure or can walk through or can be a part of on this side of planet Earth is broken. Every relationship's broken. Every company's broken. Every outcome that you and I will ever produce will be broken because we live in a fallen world. And so to take and pick apart every broken situation, every trial, every difficulty, and try to figure out what sin I've committed in the past is going to deflate me, it's going to discourage me, and it's going to prevent me from seizing the opportunity of character formation that God wants to bring about in my life. And a better question is, what is God doing in me through my current struggle? What is God trying to teach me? What is God trying to form and shape inside of me through what I'm walking in and through right now? Watch how Jesus continues this passage as the disciples want to know what sin was it. And he makes a statement. He says, "It was not because of his sins or his parents' sins," Jesus answered. "This happened so that." I want you to think back on that situation in your life, that struggle. Maybe for some of us, it's not something that happened in the past. It's something that's happening right now in this moment. That there is some form of depression, or there's some anxiety, or there's some memory from your past that keeps coming up over and over and over again. And Scripture says, Jesus says in this story, this man is not in his predicament because of his parents' choice or because of his choice. This man is in the situation. He was born blind. The day he came into planet Earth, he could not see, so that the power of God could be displayed and seen in him. That there was something that God wanted to do through his trial, through his difficulty, through his struggle, that could only happen when his situation was submitted to the hands and the power of Jesus. And today, there is a so that for you. There is hope. And the reason you're where you are today is not because God's punishing you for something from your past. Maybe God's teaching you something. Maybe he's training you to develop you. But there is the power of God that can be displayed in your life in the middle of your struggle that you are struggling, that you are walking through right now in this moment. And I love how the story finishes up. Jesus makes a statement. He says, "We must quickly carry out the task assigned to us by the one who sent us, for the night is coming and then no one can work. But while I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Notice that play on the darkness that this man must have been experiencing. That from birth, all he had seen was darkness. And Jesus says, "I've come to bring light." That the same struggle that this man walked through, the same darkness that you and I experience, Jesus is able to bring light, to shed hope, to give strength in the middle of our darkness and our struggle. So watch how Jesus solves the problem. Verse number 6, it says, "So then he spit on the ground." I just love that verse right there. There's an excuse for my kids to spit right there. "Made mud with the saliva and spread the mud over the blind man's eyes." It's like when Jesus is about to do a miracle, he spits in the ground, he makes some mud with it, he picks it up, he wipes it over the guy's eyes, and then in verse number 6, he says, "Go wash yourself in the pool of Siloam." So the man went and washed and came back seeing. And for you and I, so often when we read stories back in history, or even when we look at stories from the Bible, it's easy to forget what must have been happening in that moment, especially for the man that had been waiting by the side of the road every single day of his life, never knowing if he would ever get the opportunity to see, to peer into his daughter's eyes, or to look at the wife that he'd been married to for years, if he would ever be able to look at his parents who had cared for him for decades. This man would spend every single day of his life wondering if there was any hope for him to ever get beyond his predicament. And have you ever been there before, where you're in a struggle, where you're walking through some situation or circumstance and you're wondering, is there any way out for me? Is it going to be like this the rest of my life? Am I going to struggle with the same issue, the same sin, the same difficulty, the same trial? Is this what I'm going to be dealing with the rest of my life? Because if it is, I'm done. I want out. You ever thought that before? You're ready to throw in the towel and say, "God, I'm absolutely done with this." And this is the second fatal assumption that we all make when we walk through tragedy, trial, or difficulty. And it's this, that there's no hope for me. There's no way out. And the same Jesus that intervenes on behalf of this man who had been blind from birth is the same one that is able to intervene on your behalf when you walk through struggle, when you walk through something that is beyond your capacity, beyond your wisdom, beyond your ability, and you feel like, this is it, I'm done, I'm going to give up, there's nothing left in me. The same power that was displayed in this story is the same power that God can display in your life. Now, let me just stop for a second. I know that a lot of people at South Bay are exploring this whole idea of God, checking it out. Maybe you're not even a follower of Jesus or believe in this whole idea of God. Now, I just want to open up my heart to you and tell you some of my deepest struggles from my past and how I've gotten through them. Because sometimes you keep struggling and you keep hoping and you keep praying and nothing's changing. And how do you walk through that with hope? So if you'll allow me permission just to open up the pages of my journal and share with you, I want to share with you two stories from my past and wrestle through how do we walk through when it seems like there's no hope for us, when it seems like maybe God might even be punishing us for something we've done in the past. I'll give you the first story. Before South Bay, Stacy and I lived in Texas for 5 years too long, and it was a great experience. That was a joke. Please don't be offended if you're from Texas. Are you even awake today? You can laugh at my jokes if you want to every once in a while. So we lived in Texas for 5 years, and while we were there, we started a church on a college campus. And it was very difficult for us. In fact, there were a lot of times where we were, you know, like we are now, it's still trying to figure it out, but it wasn't working. Everything we tried just wouldn't work. And it, probably a lot of it was bad leadership. And there was a huge part of it that was just God forming and shaping us. But there was one story that tops them all. This is like the penultimate of failures, or what felt like failure. One Thursday afternoon, it's like a week after my first son, Cademan, has been born, I get a phone call. And our church met on a public university's campus in like this big pool hall room, which thinking back, it was just ridiculous. We would like shove chairs between pool tables and we'd just like kind of push people in there. Well, the coordinator of the pool hall calls me and says, hey, you guys can't meet for church on Sunday. And it's like, you know, over 100 college students that met every week. And on top of that, you can never meet here again. I'm like, dude, it's Thursday. We have 3 days. Could you imagine if that happened this, you know, with Sunnyvale Community Center or with our building at North San Jose campus? Just like, done. You can't meet. And you got to figure out how to finagle. So on top of all of this, my wife, like, you know, had just had Cademan 5 days before this. So here we are trying to figure out how to care for this newborn baby. And then this church that we just started doesn't have anywhere to meet that weekend. So I went out, I called everybody I could. I was so frustrated. And I remember having this one experience where I walked outside and it was Texas. It was like August, early September, which meant it was like 150 degrees outside. But I just knew that I needed to go for a run. So I put some tennis shoes on and I put some music on my iPod. And I just, it was back when, you know, the iPods were like that big. And I put it on my arm and I just went out for a run. And there was this verse that came to mind when I was running. And I was so frustrated with God. I'm like, God, here I am, I'm freaking trying to start a church, and you don't even open a door for us to meet in. I mean, what are you thinking, God? Are you done with us? Was this my idea, not your idea? And I remember this verse came so clear into my heart and into my mind right there in that moment. And it was this verse from James chapter 1, verse 2 through 5. The scripture says, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. Now, I'm like, there's no joy in this for me, God. Like, I have no pleasure in this whole situation. That he goes on to say this, when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. That when you're in the middle of difficulty, you're in the middle of struggle, there's something God is forming in you, shaping in you. There is a muscle that God is developing in you called perseverance that would only come if you walked through this difficulty. And if you didn't go through it, that muscle would never be developed. And then he continues on as he says, so that let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. That there is a perseverance component of the difficulty, that if I don't hang in there, if I don't stay at the table, if I don't keep pushing, if I don't persevere, that ultimately this situation that I'm in right now is not going to mature me. Have you ever been there before where you're walking through difficulty and the question is, I want to give up. I want to throw in the towel. And what scripture says is when God is taking us through training, when he's taking us through discipline, when he's taking us through hardship, that the formation doesn't come if I give up. It doesn't come if I throw in the towel. So he says, let perseverance finish its work so that you might be mature and complete, not lacking anything. And I love the way this verse finishes. And if any of you lacks wisdom, which we all do at times in our lives, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and he will give it to you. It will be given to you. And in the middle of that situation, there was like this light, this ray of hope. And all of a sudden, I was able to run a little bit faster, and I was able to stand up a little bit taller. And I said, you know, God, I know you're shaping me. I believe you're forming me. I know that there are lessons I have to learn, that there is character that has to be formed. And if I don't submit, if I give up, then I'm not going to become the person you want me to be. And I believe with all my heart, so much of what God has done through South Bay Church and all the lives that have been changed have happened in direct connection and correlation to those stories of frustration, of anxiety, of failure after failure after failure, and staying in there. Stacy, my wife, would stay in there, and we'd pray, and we'd ask God through all of it to form and shape us. And I remember in the middle of all these seasons, when everything is going different than I thought it would, realizing that if I did not stay humble and teachable, if I did not ask questions, if I did not seek to learn and grow in wisdom, then I would never form into the person that God wanted me to be. And so consequently, so many of the mentorships and relationships that I have in my life today happened from that season when I was above or beyond my capacity, beyond my ability, beyond my power, that God formed and shaped in me this hunger and this longing to do what we call now here on our staff at South Bay, to be tenaciously teachable, to keep seeking to grow. And in the middle of that trial was one of the greatest blessings that God could have ever brought into my life. And here's a question I want to just throw out there that I ask myself when I'm walking through difficulty. It's this: what is Jesus trying to do in me with this struggle? You know, here's the reality. God is way more concerned with what he is doing in you than what he is accomplishing through you. God is way more concerned with what he is doing in you than what he is accomplishing through you. And so often we want to skip the things God is doing in us so that God can do more through us. But if we don't receive what it is that God wants to do in us, then we'll never be able to step in to what it is that God wants to do through us. So right now, in the middle of your struggle, what is it that Jesus is trying to form and shape inside your heart and your character? The second story is a little bit more personal. This story comes from our struggle with infertility. And if you've ever walked through infertility, you know the pain. You know the hardship. It's one of the deepest struggles in a family's heart, especially in a woman's heart. Stacy and I almost immediately got pregnant with our first child, Cademan, and pretty quickly, about a year after, started to try for second round. Tried month after month after month after month after month. Stacy would find out month after month after month after month. And initially, we're like, okay, maybe we're not going to have a baby this year. Maybe we're not going to have a baby next year. After about 2 or 3 years, then we started asking the question, well, can we ever have another child? And at the end of all this, about 6 years after our struggle with infertility, in November of 2011, Stacy found out that she was pregnant. And I remember those days when we found out that she was pregnant, and it was one of the greatest moments of joy in my life. Of this great elation. God's blessed us after this long season of infertility. And then about 6 weeks after Stacy found out she was pregnant, she started to have some complications with her pregnancy, and we began to realize that she probably was going to lose this baby that was inside of her. And so we went to the doctor, and sure enough, 6 weeks in, there was no heartbeat left. 6 years of infertility, pregnancy with great elation, matched with the same level of disparity, frustration, and discouragement. And I was so freaking angry at God in that moment. I was like, God, you've given so many people children and babies. All we want, we'll raise this kid the way you want us to raise this kid. We'll surrender it all to you. And this one thing that we want, God, this one thing that we want, you won't give to us. And I remember Stacy and I having all these conversations. And when we were in the middle of this story, I had no idea how it would turn out. I didn't know if God would bless us with another child. We had already adopted our beautiful Sammy, and God had blessed us with him. And at the same time, we had this longing for another biological child in our family. And so about that time, I just gave it up. And Stacy and I just said, you know, God, if you don't ever want us to have another biological child, we'll surrender that to you. And so we just kind of gave it up. And a few months later, after that, we found out Stacy was pregnant again. And I wish I could be honest with you and say that there was this great elation in our family when we found out we were pregnant again. But there was fear. And every day there would be fear that somehow Stacy would find out that she was going to lose this one. And today, right before I stepped on the stage to preach, Stacy was holding in her arms our little girl that came out of that great struggle for us. and her name is Charis, which means God's grace. And what we determined through that struggle was that it's in our struggle that God's grace comes into our life. And sometimes we want it to be easy. And the pain for us is that we don't know. We don't know the end. We don't know if the cancer is going to go away. We don't know if the marriage is going to work. We don't know I know because I'm married, but you don't know if you'll ever get married. We don't know the outcome. And so faith for us through difficulty, through tragedy, through trial, is not walking through faith believing that my determined outcome is going to happen. It's walking through with a quiet confidence, knowing that there is a God that is for us and not against us, that loves us, that cares for us. And the depth of my pain, my only consolation was that the depth of the pain that we felt, our Savior, our King, our God, knew every moment, every tear, every prayer that was prayed. He knew that pain. And today he knows it for you. And there were a few verses that I found consolation in through this. And I just want to share a couple of these with you. James chapter 1, verse 12 says this: "Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial." There were so many times that I had to tell myself in that infertility struggle, there is a blessing in perseverance. And watch how this verse finishes. "Having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him." That there is a crown of life, and you don't know what that crown looks like. You don't know if it's another baby. You don't know if it's your marriage turning out the way you want it to. You don't know if it's you rebounding financially. You don't know if it's overcoming the sickness. But what we do know is those of us who are followers of Jesus, we have a hope that is not rooted in our circumstances here on planet Earth. We have a hope that is rooted in one who was brutally murdered on a cross, who triumphed over the grave, who stands with the keys to heaven and earth, who is eternal in his existence, who has always existed, and will exist forever into the future. And at the core of who this God is good. Good, kind, loving, gracious, faithful, and true. And your trial, your difficulty may not turn out on this side of planet Earth or this side of eternity the way that you hope or plan or expect that it would, but there is a blessing of God's provision and grace. And there is a crown of glory to be received that may not be received in this life, but may only be received in the next. And sometimes when it's really hard, when it's really difficult, when you're overwhelmed, when you're overloaded, when you're beyond yourself, the only thing you can do is you can keep getting up over and over and over and over again and filling your mind with truth. And convincing yourself once again that there is a God that loves you, who is for you. And this last verse I want to just read to you. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 16 was one of my great encouragements. Actually, I have two more verses. I'm sorry. Romans 8, 28 says, "And we know in all things that God works together. We know that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose for them." What this means is that God can take a seemingly difficult situation in your life, and he can work it for your good. And the same thing that Satan wants to use to destroy you, to discourage you, is the same situation and circumstance that God will use to develop you if you submit it to him. And you and I don't get to choose. We don't get to choose what our kids are going to be like. We can form and shape them, but their behavior might be different than we hope. We don't get to choose the trial, the tragedy, the difficulty that we walk through. The only thing that we get to choose is our response to it and whether or not we'll place it into the hands of God and let him carry us through that. And this last verse I want to just give to you before we sing a song together is this: "For though the righteous person falls seven times, they rise again, but the wicked stumble when calamity strikes." And some of you are here today because you need to listen to what God wants to say to you, that your step today is just to get back up. It's to just keep stepping. It's to keep rising again, to trust that there is a God that will sustain you. And you're not going to get an answer to the why behind your struggle. You're not going to get a solution of how this situation is going to end up. But what you do have and what you can have today is confidence in the goodness and the love and the mercy of God to sustain you, to help you keep standing up, to lift you up when you're down, to bring you out of the ashes, to bring life. And there is a version of you. There is a person God is creating you to become. There is a you that is more like Jesus and more like yourself that is only going to happen through the tragedy, through the trial, through the difficulty of life. And I want it to be easier. I don't want it to be so difficult. But what I'm seeing in my own journey is that because we live in a broken world, we will always experience situations and circumstances that are beyond us. And if we will submit them to Jesus and we will submit them to his work in our lives, he can form us and shape us to become who he wants us to be. So we're going to sing a song about how God brings and raises to life our hearts and can bring us out of our trial, out of our tragedy, into the life he's created us to live. So I'm going to pray for us, and then the band will be up to lead us in this song. You can stay seated, you can stand, you can write some notes down, you can pin out these answers to these questions and just wrestle through what it is that God's trying to teach you through the current situation that you're in today. Jesus, thank you today for your kindness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you that you form us through the greatest difficulties in our lives. And so often we want it to be easier. So often we want it to be a kind of life where there's no difficulty, where there's no tragedy. Yet when we look to you, Jesus, we realize that you struggled, that you went to a cross for the sins of the world, and that you were brutally murdered on our behalf so that we might have hope. And today we thank you for a story of a blind man that you gave hope to, that you placed your hands on his eyes to open his eyes to see, and the same hope that you gave to his life because of a cross and an empty tomb. You give hope to us. You can open our eyes to see you in a new way, to see our situation in a new way, to see our life through the light that you bring. And I pray today for every person that is listening to this message that you would bring hope to their hearts, that you would bring life, that you would raise us to life through your power, through your grace, and we would persevere, that when it's easier to quit, through the grace you give, through the power you give, that we would persevere and we would find our strength in you and in your grace. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus.